Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Good evening, everyone. Before we drop the gavel, we are going to ask Commissioner Massey to offer an invocation, and then we've got a special guest that's going to help us lead the Pledge of Allegiance. I'd like to recognize, before we begin, Reed Allshaus. Reed is a member of the Boy Scout Troop 65 out of Saxbahawk, affiliated with the United Methodist Church, and he is here tonight working on a merit requirement with his father, Eric. We welcome both of you, as we welcome all of you. So at this time, we'll ask Commissioner Massey to offer the invocation, and then we'll call Reed forward.
Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for you just watching over us and keeping us safe, Lord. And we just pray for all our troops that are in harm's way. And Lord, just help us tonight that we will do the right thing for Alamance County, because that's what our job is. And these things we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Chief, you'd like to come forward?
That's fine. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
Thank you. Linda, thank you.
Yes, sir.
Following call the meeting to order, welcome again to all of you. And following the call to order, we now will have our public comments. We've got two individuals that would like to speak. First call on Tony Cox, who would like to speak on ordinance reform. Mr. Cox, welcome to you, sir.
Thanks, sir.
As a business owner, if I'm from the outside or even in Alamance County and I'm wanting to start a business, one of the things that I think that I would do to try to get a find out a little about the community is look at their ordinances. And ordinances in Alamance County are used for a lot of different things. Some of them are law enforcement areas, some of them are just height restrictions and so forth, and I've even seen them to as a good accommodation for people. On the other side of it is, if I'm a neighbor and I'm mad at you, I can wreck your world. I can totally wreck your world. I can call somebody and not say who I am and send them on a path, maybe justified, maybe not justified, to where something minute just blows up into a big thing. And one of the things that I'm wanting to ask for tonight in what I'm talking about with ordinance reform is, I think a lot of these ordinances are being abused and misused. And if you go back to the special subcommittees on the high impact land use ordinance of 2011, it did come out that there had possibly been some abuse and misuse with the ordinances. And I think a good path to try to straighten that out may be that if you want to file a complaint against someone, then you have to fill out a complaint form to where in the chain of evidence with our rights, our constitutional rights, it shouldn't change here, there, here, there, here, there, that you are on a guiding, you know, you're on a line that you can follow rather than it switch swapping and friends getting involved and possibly some conflicts of interest. So I hope that based on things from the past, and we're trying to learn, that's all we can do is try to learn, that we can look at these in some reform matters and move forward with these ordinances. I think they, even in some of them, they're even restricting business, especially, you know, with the, I think one's going to be speaking about tonight maybe is the watershed ordinance. And if you look at the allotted lot sizes for that at 12%, 12% is not a lot of size when you're looking at an acre of land, 44,000 square feet. So you go with 12% of that, I think is what it is, and I could be wrong on that. And I don't know if that includes driveways, the house. Thank you.
Thank you, Scott. Just a point of clarification. Jason, the public hearings that you have on your agenda tonight, that's not to schedule a public hearing, that's to have the public hearing. Is that right?
No, it's the scheduled public hearing.
To schedule it?
No. I'm sorry.
It is the scheduled public hearing.
Yes.
So if individuals want to speak on these specific changes, they can do so tonight. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
So, Mr. Cox, if you've got something specific about these two,
yes,
you can certainly return at that time.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you. And our other speaker is Mr. Eddie Hsu that would like to talk about the DOJ. Eddie, welcome to you.
Bye. Commissioners, Mr. Chairman, this morning, Mr. Sutton there got me thinking when he started talking about on the radio people taking responsibility. And so I'm here to get y'all to thinking about possibly taking some responsibility. Another sheriff's stick, I hope Tim said he's doing pretty good, and I'm glad of that. But I want to read you this. This is what it's come to. This is from Times News last week. According to ICE, deportation cases in Alamance County are not being closed solely because of the DO's accusations in a September 18th report. The charges, however, are being taken into consideration when ICE makes a determination on whether or not to close a deportation case. Now, the reason I bring this up, in the article they talked about this guy's lawyer had brought this up, and here they say they consider it. And this guy's back on the street on account of this DOJ thing. Now, Mr. Sutton has numerous times brought up the matter of illegals and driving cars and killing people drunk. Well, I'm here to say that if that would have happened in this case, some of the blame falls here. Y'all are leaders. You can support our sheriff, but still move this process along. We're fixing to go into the discovery phase. Well, I'm hopeful that it don't happen. But if you get a couple of deputies and they depose them and they say something, well, and it is against another deputy, so they retaliate, you may be going to need that big raise that they want. Because people, it could get ugly. Law enforcement is a tricky business. They walk a tricky line. Everybody knows that. So I'm asking y'all to take some responsibility. Perhaps say, when the sheriff gets buzzed, say, Sheriff, make a resolution. We support you 100%. But for the good of the county, to get our people in jail before somebody up here on a jury has of nagging doubt in the back of their head about a deputy's testimony, and some murderer walks the streets, or some vicious fellow in a case like this, say, we took what action we can. But I want you all to be able to sit there and say, there's no blood on my hands. I want him to be able to say, there's no blood on my hands if that guy that was let loose last Friday goes out here and crashes into somebody. Because I think no license was what he was charged with. And he was given a deportation, but he had a hearing. And they said, nah, I'll go back home.
Thank you, Eddie.
Eddie, let me ask you something. If they catch you for driving without license, what are they going to do to you?
Well, I don't know. I can tell you what they're doing to me, because my dogs, the wind blowed my tent down, the dogs got loose. But I can't. Now
what
I can't tell you about that till I get
to
court.
What are they gonna do to you with your dog?
They're gonna find out. I'll go to court about it because the way it's ruled, it ain't right. But if I get caught without a license, I would say 9 times out of 10, they're gonna say, "Give me your name, give me your age." They're gonna call down if my description pretty well matches it. They're gonna take my word for it. Now I'm not. That's what I'm saying. This guy.
You don't think they'd take you to jail?
Well, maybe me.
For not having a driver's license.
Maybe me, after what I said.
Everybody it should be treated the same. If they shouldn't treat you any different, then they treat the illegals.
You're missing my point, Bill. They took this guy to jail. And because of this mess, he's back home instead of in Mexico. That's what I'm telling you.
Oh, I agree.
In other words, you know, I don't know what else to tell you. I mean, yeah, good gosh. And what can I say? I mean, there are people walking. If it happens, if I was on a jury and I say, well, maybe that deputy is fudging the truth and it's a felony that's got in here and hurt somebody really bad, and I'm saying, maybe they fudged evidence, maybe they didn't do this, and I get a reasonable doubt, somebody dangerous could walk this street, Bill. Instead of just me and Bob.
Any commissioner responses?
Yeah, I'd like to say, if anybody believes it, that what the catch and let go is our fault, I think that's beyond the pale. I mean, it's all across the United States, people that aren't doing anything. I mean, my Lord, you had an illegal alien hit a kid at a bus stop outside of Dunn, Irwin, knocked him 158 feet, and papers, they said school papers were flying everywhere, and he'd already been caught by the police three times and let go. And no, it's a point to the federal government, a weak government, weak leadership, a weak position on illegal immigration, and blame them. Don't blame us. I mean, my goodness, we did what we were supposed to do. We had guts enough to do what we should have done. And the fact that we're being challenged, I don't think anything, that certainly was a downside to have a challenge, but to think that it's our fault that somebody here locally has been let go, I mean, that was the national agenda after the election, if it went a certain way. Turn a blind eye to it, have so-called comprehensive immigration reform, which is a joke, and then pay the price later. And part of paying the price is letting people go, just like you say, but it's hardly our fault locally. We did what we could do until we were stopped by people in Washington. Simple, very simple, cut and dry. If the election had gone a different way, we would have had more tools to use and more ability to do what we ought to do as a nation. But we have a weak leadership out of Washington on this issue. There's an ulterior motive for it. Our country just didn't get millions and millions of illegal immigrants just by happenstance. It's all part of a plan. And we tried to use the federal laws to do something about it, and we were stopped. But to say that we have done something negligent by doing what we should have done, and now we're being challenged by the Justice Department, win or lose, I think it's a little short-sighted. That's my personal opinion.
Any other commissioner comments this time? If not, we'll go on to item 4, which is the approval of the agenda, which would include approval of the consent agenda. First of all, let me ask Mr. Honeycutt, do we have any changes to the agenda that are not reflected on our latest version here?
No, sir.
And thank you. Is there any item on the consent agenda that any commissioner would like pulled?
I'd like to pull A1.
Okay, the appointments to the Human Relations Council will now be for discussion, and we can.
And I'd like to table that appointment till another time.
Okay, we probably should pull it and discuss it, and then make that recommendation, if that's all right.
Okay, that's the legal way to do it.
Okay. Any other items on consent agenda that we need to remove? If not, we'll accept a motion or entertain a motion to approve the agenda, including the consent agenda items, with the understanding that item A1 will no longer be on consent, but we'll probably, let's go ahead and talk about that next, if that's all right with everybody. Okay. Is there a motion to approve the agenda with that change to the consent agenda?
So moved.
Thank you. Is there a second? Thank you, Linda. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, the agenda has been approved. Bill, you want to go ahead and let's discuss that item now then?
Well, I think it's just one. Two of them, I don't think there's any objection.
Yeah, I agree. It's just one of those three.
And the reason, I don't think the reason
been
that I have,
enough.
Excuse me, Bill.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
The reason that I have on the Mr. Zienti is that he's only been in Alamance County for a year and a half, And I just think we can find somebody a little more qualified to serve on this board, because it's a very important board, I think, in the county.
Craig, where do we get the recommendations from this council? Is there a, do they have a nominating committee? How do they?
From the chair. The chairman of the Human Relations Council submits the application.
And who is that?
Alexa Jordan.
And was there any openings? Three?
They have several, but she just submitted those three. Two were reappointments and one was a new appointment.
Did we already do the reappointments?
That was the first two.
Oh, I see. Okay, so the first two are reappointments and the third one is new, and that's the one we're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What's your pleasure? Do we send it back to that council?
I think so. I'm all in favor of the other two reappointments. I don't know about Bill. I think...
I'm fine with the reappointments.
Yeah.
Okay, is it a consensus of the board?
Yeah, I'd like to see a list of everybody that's on their board.
That's a good idea.
Yeah, see a list of all of them and their expiration dates.
They do have terms then?
Mm-hmm, they do.
Okay. Can we get that together for the next meeting?
Uh-huh.
And send this one back with reservation relating to length of time in the county?
I can.
That all right there, Blake?
Yep.
Okay. Thank you. Next item is public hearing. Invite Jason Martin to come forward. Now, Jason, you've got two separate items, so after your presentation on each one, we'll ask for comments or input from our guests.
Okay.
If that'll work for you.
That is fine with me. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, good evening. The first public hearing that we have here this evening is for the Watershed Protection Ordinance. And you should have in your packet a copy of the proposed amendments to the ordinance, as well as a map. And just to kind of give you a little bit of background of this is relating to an intake that the city of Greensboro installed on the Hall River in northeastern Guilford County. It's an emergency intake where they would pull water out of the Hall River in times of a drought. To my knowledge, they have used it in 2007 and 2008. I believe the intake was put in the early 2000s at some time. I do apologize. I don't know the exact date on that. In any event, the state of North Carolina Division of Water Quality, with the watershed rules, require that anytime an intake is put in, that they have to reclassify the watershed. And this particular watershed did not have any kind of restrictions or regulations in Alamance County or Guilford County, I believe, for that matter, Rockingham, until this time. And the state has reclassified that watershed to a WS4. With each classification, there is a minimum amount of regulations that must be put into place for that watershed area. Now, the map that we've got on the screen here, just so that you can see the broad scheme of things, this is the entire watershed area. In the small corner there in the northwestern corner of Alamance County, roughly, we've proposed in our map amendment to the state to run it along the road so it would make a little more sense. Along Jug House Road to 87 to the county line.
Jason, hold.
Yes, sir.
Is there any way we can just temporarily turn one of those sets of lights off? I'm having trouble seeing that.
Oh.
I can't read.
It's not the best map. I apologize. It's the only one the state had available.
That's good. Thanks, Brian.
But where you see the star down there in the red area, that is the critical area, and that is where the actual intake is on the river. Which is not very wide at all at that point, just for information. But the northwestern corner of Alamance County is the portion that would be classified, and a new watershed is created with that. And it would be considered a balance of watershed area, meaning that it's outside of the half mile critical.
Does that work? That intake still work?
Yes, it does. That is a new intake that they put in. And they only will use it in times of drought, the city of Greensboro. But it impacts a great deal of Rockingham County, a little bit of Caswell County, and a pretty good amount of Guilford County as well. And so you should have in your packet the actual proposed amendment, which would create the Upper Hall River watershed. And that was created, the name of it was created by staff. It was pretty much left up to us at that point. Being that there's already a Hall River watershed in Alamance County, to avoid confusion, we called it the Upper Hall.
Do we have a Lower Hall?
Well, just the Hall River watershed that runs down around the Sykes Pile area.
Your house?
But in Appendix A, this would be an appendix that would apply only to this watershed. The minimum lot size would be 1/2 acre for residential or non-residential use. If there are multiple uses on the same piece of property, there has to be 1/2 acre per use. So if there's a residential or multifamily residential, for example, somebody wants to put in 5 townhomes, they're going to have 2.5 acres of land to be able to do that. Built upon area not to exceed 24% for new development, and that is impervious area. That's any area that's impervious to water. That includes pavement, buildings, and gravel as well. The state of North Carolina requires that gravel be considered impervious surface. And then non-residential, again, no lot will be less than 1/2 acre. And it is, as well, 24% built upon area requirement. There are some allowed uses and some uses that are prohibited. Pretty much the only things that are prohibited in this district would be sites for application of residuals or petroleum, discharging landfills and the storage of hazardous materials unless a spill containment plan is implemented. And the spill containment plan is given through the fire marshal's office for all businesses that store hazardous chemicals. They do tier 2 reporting and such. But non-residential development, residential, commercial, industrial, educational, religious, all of those are allowed in that area. However, development, with the exception of single family homes and residential construction, would require a watershed permit. And those are done on administrative approval with the planning department. It would follow the same procedures that we've done for all other watersheds in the county. To kind of put this in a different perspective, this is the other map that's in your packet. The blue area, that is the new watershed that would be created. Everything that's in green across the street is actually already watershed. Existing balance of watershed area, which is actually a little more restrictive. Those have 12% built upon requirements and 1 acre minimum lot size requirements. Those have been established for years, and that's currently the rules there. That being said, I would be glad to take any questions that the board may have from me at this time.
Mr. Chair, I think it's also important to say that these are the minimum requirements of the state. We're not putting anything more restrictive under Jordan Lake rules than the state is mandating that we put in. So this is basically taking the state requirements and putting it in as minimally as we have to.
Did the state requirements change as a result of the Jordan Lake rules as it relates to this particular type of watershed?
That somewhat. But again, these are just minimum requirements we have to do that's required by the state.
How is that land perk up there?
Typically speaking, in the northern part of the county, the land doesn't perk well. There are some areas that are better than others, but typically speaking, in the northern part of the county, the land, they have a hard time getting it to perk.
Where does Greensboro sewer sewage enter into the rivers at?
That I don't know. I honestly don't know. I'm not sure that they have any discharge there.
It's all treated anyway, isn't it?
I believe so.
If you put it back in the whole river, it's treated waste.
Yeah, I don't know of them having a treatment facility up in that part of Guilford County.
They don't.
Well, they don't, but the creek that they put it into does run into the Hall River in the northern part of Guilford County, and that creek in the treatment center has been known to overflow an awful lot.
That's Buffalo?
Buffalo Creek.
Okay. Buffalo Creek.
You notice we've got a border with Rockingham County? Does Bruce know that?
Like it's straight.
Oh, yes.
Alleged. That's an alleged border.
Other questions from the commissioners? This is required by State of North, I guess, what, Diener?
Yeah, Division of Water Quality. And they actually also failed to mention, they did hold a public hearing on this in September of 2011 when they actually did the reclassification of the watershed. I believe it was held in Reidsville, if memory serves me correct, for all of the counties that were impacted. They published that at that time for the residents. Well,
going back to your other map.
Yes, sir.
Can you go backwards once? So we're doing this for that little northwest corner, but what you're saying is everything in that kind of dotted area?
Yeah, the checkered
other counties
area.
Are having to do the same thing. So you've got, what, Caswell has to do it, Rockingham has to do it, and Guilford?
Yes.
All the same.
And my understanding is the other three have already passed everything. We're the last ones at this point.
Okay. Well, if there are no questions from the commissioners at this time, this is a public hearing, so if there are individuals in the room tonight that would like to speak on this specific subject, that is the northwest part of the county being deemed a newly termed Upper Haw River watershed. Are there any folks that would like to speak on that? Eddie, please come forward. Welcome again.
Thank you again.
It seems to me that once it gets to down to Raleigh, there's not a lot that can be done about it. Gosh, I wish you could. But I noticed the place over here, like Buttermilk Creek, got nothing to do with the Haw River till it gets down and runs through, you know, the Broughton Lake and all out through there, you know. And then, you know, we've been drinking the water for 18 years. So I can't see what happened now, because Buttermilk Creek, when I worked at the water plant up there at Broughton 3.5 years, and I used to hate a big rain because that it's so alkaline up there that it made the water real hard to treat. And so I don't see how in the world that affects Greensboro over there, but good gosh, what can you do with the state? I wish we'd done like Virginia's state attorney general did. It took the whole bunch of them to court and beat them. On the federal level. And he says, you know, you're not going to do this to us. And there was a lot of talk about that. That would have been my fight to prefer. If we're going to fight the feds, that would have done them good. That's a bunch of money, so carry it and drink water is basically what all this boils down to. And but anyway, it's probably too late now, but I don't see, you know, Buttermilk Creek don't run over into that side. But it eventually does empty into Haw River after we drink it. So maybe, that, you know, what can you say? I mean, that, you know, that just shows their thinking. I mean, yeah. The Buttermilk Creek and all that, everything that side of that road there runs back into our watershed, which we've been drinking since I was around here. And now all of a sudden it affects the Haw River somehow, somewhere else, and it ain't affected it up to now. But.
Thank you, Eddie. Other comments about this specific topic?
Tony's.
Oh, I'm sorry, Tony. Come forward.
What was it that I heard you say between the balance and the critical? Was it 24% critical?
This particular, the Upper Haw River watershed would be 24% built upon area. There are other watersheds in the county that are considered balanced watershed. Those are 12%. This has got a little bit, allows for more impervious surface than the other existing watersheds.
And you can't, that can't be adjusted to 12% in the balance for a little bit more?
To adjust the other watersheds to 24% where it allows more?
Yeah.
Not
for the balance?
Not really, not to critical. My understanding, because the state sets that based on the classification that what they classify the watershed at. So if it's at a WS2 or WS3, it's got different requirements. This particular one allows for 24% as the minimum. We can adjust it to where it's more restrictive. No. But we've chosen to go the bare minimum the state's asked for.
Because with a 1 acre tract of land, that kind of, you know, somebody wants to build a big house out there, and there are people building big houses. You know. The other thing I would wonder, you're saying 87 is the thing up there. Would that inhibit something like, now I know we've seen Dollar General go out on 87. So let's say Family Dollar wanted to go up there on that upper end up there, say where the Stony Mountain Road or the Stony Creek Church.
If it's in the watershed area and they're wanting to say, we'll use family dollar as an example. In the balance area, they would have to do a watershed permit with the planning department, and that built upon area would apply. They could not exceed more than 12%. They're parking, they're building, everything.
And that would pretty much stop a convenience store altogether, wouldn't it?
Depends on the size of the lot. You know, if it's, and in those cases, it's a minimum 1 acre lot, so you're looking at 43,560, roughly 5,000 square feet. Yeah, just doing the math quick off.
And no petroleum at all.
They can do that, but they have to get, they have to have spill containment plans with the fire marshal's office to do that. They have to provide proof of that.
Right.
So it is possible.
What about enforcement?
For watershed?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the planning department is charged with the enforcement of the watershed.
I think that we could look back at that ordinance and maybe tweak it some, especially in the ordinance. Did you ever take an oath yet?
For the watershed?
For anything.
I took an oath as watershed administrator.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All right, thank you.
Thanks, Tony.
Other individuals invited to come forward, talk about the Haw River proposed upper watershed.
We don't have a choice, do we?
Doesn't sound like it.
No, we're not from the state. They dictate what we can do and what we can't.
Pass it and move on.
Time your hands.
Are you looking for a action item that we approve this proposed ordinance?
Yes, sir.
Is there such a motion? Did I hear David?
I'll make the motion.
Oh, thank you, Linda. This time I'll declare that the public hearing is closed. David, do you have a motion?
I have a motion that we approve the ordinance as presented by you.
Okay, Jason?
I'll second.
Thank you. David, Bill, any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? No, I'm glad you're here. Straight. Now we're going to talk about a wireless communication ordinance amendment. Welcome, Jason.
Thank you, sir. You should have in your packet a copy of the proposed amendments to the wireless communication facilities ordinance. Basically, the ordinance, the amendments that are proposed are to intended to allow a little more flexibility within that ordinance, as well as to remove some ambiguous language and conflicting language within the ordinance. And I'll just kind of briefly cover these amendments real quick. In Section 9, we're proposing to change the title of that to just waivers. And it would state that a property owner may petition the Board of Commissioners of the County of Alamance to waive any requirements as set forth in this ordinance, as opposed to limiting it to just items in Section 8 of the ordinance.
This is everything that you highlighted for us in yellow?
That is correct, sir. Okay. And anything that's got a line through it is what we're proposing to delete. And then in Section 10, Development Standards for Wireless Communications Towers, subsection A, 2, we're proposing to delete the language there of the Alamance County Planning Board. As it currently would read, it states that a tower that is proposed to exceed 90 feet in height must receive approval from both the Planning Board and the Board of Commissioners. The Planning Board is solely an advisory board. That decision would rest solely with the Board of Commissioners. So if the Planning Board were to deny it, then of course the applicant could appeal it to the Board of Commissioners. And then Section B, setbacks. Wireless communication facility must be located at least the height of the tower times 1.5 from any residential structure, as opposed to any property line. And then adding language there that the setback requirement may be reduced with design certification by an engineer. As it has been explained to us that now engineers are able to design towers in such a way that they will implode, they'll actually collapse on themselves. It used to be where they would break, they assumed it breaking at the base, or they would break at the middle, particularly with lattice towers, they could tumble completely over. Now engineers can design these to collapse actually within themselves. So it gives a little bit of flexibility to the design of the engineer. And at the end of the day, the planning board's logic on that was it's the engineer's seal on it. They're certifying that it'll break that way. And they've got liability if it doesn't, I guess. And then number two, deleting that entire section because it is conflicting in language. Elsewhere in the ordinance, it states that a wireless communications facility tower doesn't necessarily have to be 1.5 times the fall zone away from that person's house if they live on the property. The same person owns the property and the home. And then in another section here, it states that it does have to be 1.5 times away. So just deleting that out to clear up the language in it.
And you've summarized that, haven't you, in your next? Well, no, past that.
Yeah.
The planning board sent to us looks like.
Is the statement of plan consistency. Yes. The planning board did vote unanimously to recommend approval of these amendments, and they also adopted this statement of plan consistency for you all specifically the Alamance County Planning Board finds that the Alamance County Land Development Plan directs the county to promote flexibility in its development ordinances and to develop conscious strategies for proactively managing the type of growth that is consistent with the county's overall vision and goals. Furthermore, the planning board finds that the proposed amendments are necessary to remove ambiguous and conflicting language within the ordinance. And the planning board voted in November unanimously to recommend approval of these amendments, and they passed the statement of plan consistency at their regular meeting in January of 2013. And with that, I'll be glad to take any questions from the board at this time.
Questions from commissioners?
You don't have any provisions in there that have to be decorated as trees, do you?
No, sir. There's no rule saying they have to do that.
I know. In Guilford County, I swear they have got cell towers with fake limbs on them so they look like trees.
Sachs has one down RTP. and what's funny about that one is the whole level of trees, and then there's this thing sticking way above it.
It looks worse than if you just put up the tower.
I've seen one as a palm tree. One as a palm tree, down in Florida. So,
other comments from the commissioners?
We fought zoning in this county for 80 years, and the state comes in and stones it for us.
This is a public hearing. We'll now open the public hearing for questions from our guests. If anyone would like to talk specifically about this proposed ordinance, which has to do with wireless communications and their locations. Are there any folks that would like to address the board? If not, we'll call the public hearing to a close and would at this time entertain a motion to approve the ordinance as presented by staff.
So moved.
Second. Thank you, Bill. Any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Jason, thank you. Thank you very much. Next item on the agenda is tax lien advertisements, and we're going to welcome Jeremy Akins to the board. Jeremy, while you're on your way, I would like to make an announcement to everyone that Mr. Akins recently completed all the requirements for certification as a county assessor in North Carolina. And the Office of the North Carolina Department of Revenue is honored to issue you a certificate to that effect that's signed by the Secretary of Revenue. I hope you got the original one, because all I got was the photocopy.
Exactly, yes.
So,
yes.
Congratulations.
Thank
to you.
Appreciate
very,
that.
Very, very well. Thank Welcome you. And good luck as you proceed on as right now our interim tax assessor.
Thank you.
Administrator.
That.
But that's not why you're here.
No, more about business. North Carolina General Statute 105-369A requires the tax collector to report to the governing body the total amount of any unpaid taxes for the current fiscal year that are liens on real property. Upon receipt of the report, the governing body must order the tax collector to advertise the tax liens by publishing each lien at least once in a newspaper having general circulation within the county. The advertisement cost is assessed to each real property parcel and added to the unpaid tax bill. That means that once you're advertised, when you pay, there will be a small assessment to cover the cost of advertisement so that it's not borne by the other citizens. The tax collector has determined the cost of $5. This is the same amount that we used last year. There probably will be a slight increase in the cost, but we had enough to cover it last time. We think there's no need to increase our fee. Bankruptcy law prevents the advertising of taxes filed under a bankruptcy claim. Therefore, no 2012 tax liens under bankruptcy will be advertised. As of January 31st, the total amount of liens against real property is $3,829,603.87. We're basically even with where we were last year. What we did see in the collections coming in is that in the month of August with the reduced discount, we were behind about 4.5%. But as the year came around, we caught up. And as of the end of January, we're back at our normal collection percentage, at least as regards real property. That's the number I reviewed this evening.
Jeremy, is that percentage number of citizens or dollar amount?
Dollar amount.
That's your dollar amount. So you're in essence flat.
Right, exactly. And that's good because our collections rate has actually been very strong. It's interesting to look at the total outstanding amount. There's 4.3 million total outstanding for real property. Well, 3.8 of that is what we're just now beginning to advertise. Half a million of that is just last year. And then the other half a million is, sorry, the other 250,000 is the previous 8 years. So you can see without about 2 years to collect, you have 99% of the revenues brought in, which is actually a very good collections rate. Our staff has worked very hard.
And if I might, Clyde, you were telling me that once you get to 7 or 8 or 9 years, you want to do something before it goes 10 years and you can't do it anymore. Is that right?
That's correct.
So
after 10 years, it's gone.
Exactly.
And we have a couple of those in process. Is that right?
I have a few of them in process. We do. Mm-hmm.
And Clyde has been an incredible resource for the tax department with Robin Smith as well in working foreclosure cases and cases that need legal support. Generating quite a bit of revenue, catching some of these old cases before they go off the radar.
Is there much you can do with it when it gets to that point?
The real property, yes. The only reason that we fail to collect any real property is if there's an ownership issue. So sometimes if the property was combined or split after the bill was levied, ownership may now be unclear and we can't proceed against it unless we can get a clear line of ownership. Now, with a register of deeds, you have to certify taxes as paid. In the future, that shouldn't be a problem, or at least it would be extremely rare if it is.
Okay.
Tonight, you're looking just simply for approval to advertise in the two papers.
Exactly. We're recommending March 20th for Times News and March 21st for Alamance News at a cost of $5 per parcel.
That's what we're charging?
That's the fee that would be assessed to it. The cost will be based on the advertising space, but as those bills are paid, $5 will be taken off of each one to reimburse the advertising expense.
Any questions for Jeremy? Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Damon.
Could I ask him a question? He and I were talking today about something else, and you know, I mentioned to you Forsyth County had just finished up a 4-year reval, and with an anticipated real estate the stagnation in the real estate market, and we've got a reval coming up. Do we address a reval any differently when we think it might be like Forsyth, where they had such a drastic cut? I mean, I think they said they were going to raise taxes 6 cents to be revenue neutral due to them. I find it hard to believe, but I haven't really studied it that close. But do you approach a reval any differently when in a normal situation versus a stagnation deflation?
The process is fundamentally the same, and it really relies on the final years we're coming into the revaluation to take a snapshot of the market. So if that market is down, then obviously we're following it down. Now, there are some differences potentially in the appeals process. Obviously, when you have a strong rate of growth, that 8-year difference is more noticeable. If there's a flat line or a decline, of course, that's easier for the taxpayer to understand and accept. So we might see fewer appeals based on that. Now, we'll note that, unfortunately, in 2009, the revaluation process was highly inconsistent. So there are cases out there where properties have been badly undervalued. The ones that were overvalued came forward and we were able to fix most of those. The ones that are undervalued, a lot of times we won't notice until the next reval. So there still will be some cases of prices jumping, but that's just correcting the 2009.
And we probably haven't had that situation before that you described.
No. This will be the first time.
I agree. I think we're going to be unpleasantly surprised when we do revenue neutral and it's resulting in an increase in the tax rate. Then what do we do? However, we do have a motion and a second. And any other questions or discussion? Excuse me. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Chairman,
thank you.
And again, congratulations to you. County Manager Report. Craig, you have some items for us?
Yes, sir, I do. A couple of things. Wanted to make sure everybody had on their calendar our meeting on March 6th with the Alamance Burlington School System. It will be a joint meeting held at the Family Justice Center from 11 a.m. to about 1 p.m. So we're currently working on the agenda with their staff, and as soon as I get their agenda completed, we'll be sending all that information out to you. But wanted to make sure that you had that on your calendars.
How long do you anticipate that meeting?
2 hours, and we will have lunch during that time as well, since we're starting at 11.
That's the communication.
Okay.
I actually had a couple of people ask me that would like to attend but can't get away for the full 2 hours. Is it going to be a working lunch, or are we going to meet for a while and then take a break, or are we going to eat first and then, or do we know?
Lunch will be at 11 and meet us.
Lunch is at 11. Thank you. Appreciate Tori so much. Lunch is at 11, and the meeting will start at 11:30.
Okay. So if anybody asks, because it is open to the public, obviously.
Right.
And it's right in the conference room downstairs.
Yes,
at
sir.
The Justice Center.
Yes, sir.
So really, the meeting will be from 11:30 to about 1.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Other reports or announcements?
I did want to give you an update on, we had discussion at our last meeting about the consolidation of DSS and Health Department. We've been working very diligently. I appreciate the work Brian's doing with Susan and Barry. We're still trying to compile numbers. We didn't have anything ready for you tonight. I didn't want you to think we'd forgotten about it, but we're definitely working on that, and hopefully we'll have something ready for you in a couple of weeks to present to you.
Have we received, I haven't received, the financial reports for the first 6 months?
I believe we have, but I'll make sure you got it. Yes, sir. We'll resend those out. Yes,
okay.
Sir.
Okay. Thanks.
We're sure we saw it.
Yeah. But we'll be glad to resend it. We're in actually pretty good shape. You know, revenue is up a little bit. Some of our expenditures that were up, we were able to justify. And again, I apologize. It's top of my head. But we're in good shape compared to this time last year. Any questions about that?
Yeah, everybody go.
Okay.
Okay. And I do want to give you a quick update on Grand Manor. Again, I want to thank Commissioner Sutton and Commissioner Smith for getting the Masons in touch with us. We did have a capsule opening last week, and I appreciate our maintenance staff as well. It was a reopening of something that was opened up in 85 or in the mid 80s.
I think it was like 87 or something. It wasn't that long ago.
Yeah, so the good stuff was taken out. But it was a very nice event. Did appreciate the Masons and their efforts. They had a great showing. But it was really nice that we were able to work with them. Just to give you a kind of a calendar of where we're going on that, the asbestos abatement started today. I do believe, at least that was on the calendar, they should have started today. That will take approximately 3 weeks to complete. And then beginning March 11th, we should look at the demolition, and that'll take approximately 4 to 6 weeks.
4 to 6 or 46?
4 to 6. It's my Eastern North Carolina accent. So. 4 to 6.
Well, let's get the brick on that building.
We're getting the brick, and we're going to use that as crush and run out of the landfill. So that's going to help keep our costs down as far as the demolition.
What about any wood?
The
DH is
They're yeah. taking everything else. We're right. just keeping the brick.
They tore down an old mill in Greensboro and off of Market Street. They had brick just stacked up mm-hmm. out there. I mean, if somebody was going to get it, yeah. use it. They weren't going to crush it.
And I guess if there are citizens who would like to have a brick, is to let us know. We'll be glad to save some, you know, if there's any interest in having that.
Is there a market for, you know, we talked about this before. Is there a market for that?
Not that we're aware of. I do believe that the stainless steel that's inside.
D.H. Griffin owns the entire contents of the building now, which is not much. There is some stainless parts of the built-in building. Some of the brick may have value on the original section, but it depends on if they can clean it. You know, that brick, they can clean a little bit easier. Sometimes it will just turn to powder when they clean it. The two wings or the newer parts, that brick's not worth very much. So we'll probably get all of that brick and a good portion of the original section unless they can clean it up.
How many? There was at least two, if not three, different phases, right? As far as there's the original brick, and then there's
wings, the two wings,
and that's all just the two.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Well, while you're talking about facilities, and Tim, if you don't mind, I'd like to go ahead and bring the subject up now.
Yeah. Okay.
Rather than wait till after close.
Yeah, that's fine. I don't have any notes or anything on it, or it wasn't really thinking about it as long as but no, I. After the meeting we had the other week where we had a consensus, was it a consensus or a vote, actual vote?
Consensus.
To not go any further with the bid process on the rest home. I started having tremendous second thoughts about it, and at least I admit it, and I wasn't real comfortable. And so I called Craig and I asked him, you know, about, you know, wasn't there some other way to look at this to make sure we weren't going to get stuck with this thing years later, or you know, because you do have high school looming here where we're going to have about $1 million in it, and it was only appraised at $1 million, and I don't want to see that happen twice. So, you know, and so Craig said yes, they were still interested possibly in talking. And
that we have had some, once we contacted them back, and Ben Pierce, the assistant county attorney, said, the board, thanks for the offer, but this time we're not interested in further into the discussion. They were still interested. They said, we still want to come back to you. We still feel like that there's value to us and that there would be value to you. And we said, well, we've not been authorized by the board to enter into any future negotiations, but if you want to make an offer, you know, you can make an offer. So there's a lot of variables that are involved in that building. There's the land, there's the beds, and there's the building. And so, you know, and the revenue that's generated from that. And you know, as the board's aware, the beds are the most valuable thing, it's the most valuable asset. The problem is that we've heard on the building is, even though they have 110 beds allocated, they can only get in 100 patients. Because the rooms are
too small
for today's modern medical equipment, so they're underutilizing that facility now. So their, you know, their revenue, you know, if they were able to ever build a new facility, would be greatly enhanced by, you know, even the addition of 10 more beds. And we kind of did some quick math on that if you add $5,000 a month, 10 beds, $50,000 a month more revenue. That's about $500,000 a year. So that there's a lot of money they're leaving on the table, and that's the reason why they're so interested in the beds.
Can I comment also?
Yeah,
after sure. I actually read your question about it, I called one of my buddies at the hospital and asked him, okay, who's really in charge of the beds? And he looked it up, and it's listed on the states, I guess it's through DHHS, that Peak actually has the authority to go to 120 beds. That's what's on the report.
Right.
But he was saying that should there be a change, the state has to come back and approve or reapprove whoever would have the authority to
That's
have the bed.
Correct.
And we don't we don't by default get them back.
They have to they have a public hearing, and usually the health department's involved in it. We had that when the Graham Manor building was sold. They had beds there that had to be approved by Department of Health and Human Services. And we had a hearing in one of the courtrooms downstairs as to whether it was advisable for them to move those beds from Graham Manor to Swepsonville. They built a new facility down there. And there was no objection to it.
Well, and we do have, I guess, in our clause that should we want to do something with it, they have right of first refusal anyway.
That's correct. Right? And they have 3 more years on the lease, current lease. I think they have an option to renew for another 5.
Well, in their defense, I'm not sure I'd want to plow a whole bunch of money into the facility now if the lease could terminate. I didn't know about the renewal option. But I kind of agree with Tim that it was a little kind of confusing the way, just like what you said tonight, you've got the land, you've got the buildings, and then you've got the beds. And
we also have a tower out there for a sign on the highway that we're leasing to.
We own that too. We want to hold on to that, definitely, didn't we?
Right.
Sure.
Well, Tim, what would you like to see happen?
Well, frankly, just for starters, how much time have we got?
There's plenty of time.
Yeah. And I'd like to see a synopsis, if that's the right word, or a history of the whole project out there. In other words, start to where we're at today. I mean, I'm still confused about the process. I'm not going to lie to you.
A timeline or a chronology?
Yeah, timeline of the ownership, how do we get in to start with, and answer some basic questions. I mean, like if they decided to move out, is it a guarantee that they wouldn't get to bed? I mean, I don't want to be stuck with the building. The building needs a lot of work, in my opinion.
Is prime property right there.
Yeah, I realize that.
That is prime.
That's why we all get prime price.
On Woody Drive is worth a fortune. Just the land for a motel right at that intersection, man, that's big.
We got a hotel right beside it, haven't we?
Yeah, but it's a...
What is the benefit to the county to sell it? I don't see any benefit.
Well, I see millions of dollars.
How many millions?
Well, that's just it.
We're getting $400,000 a year now, right?
Yes, sir.
We don't have to do a thing. I mean, that check just comes in, and we don't have any expense whatsoever. We've got 3 years on that lease. If they move out, Susan, isn't it true the county keeps the beds, or the beds stay there?
I think there is a process through division of, but yes, I mean, we just went through the process and it changed hands about a year ago.
That's right.
The former
tenant had the right to the beds, and
they
then signed them to the new tenant.
Right. What was our role in that?
Through the lease with us.
Yes. Right.
Yeah. Through the lease with us.
2 years ago is when they done it.
Yes.
Well, to net $400,000 from an investment with today's interest rates, you're going to have to invest over $10 to $12 million. Are they willing to pay that? If they're willing to talk about $10 to $12 million to begin with, I certainly would be willing to talk. But otherwise, we're losing, stand to lose revenue. And I think if they move out, somebody else is going to want to move in just about as fast.
The beds is where the money's at. If they just have a facility.
I have no objection to talking to them, but I mean, but
that's the question. What Bill just said, if they move out, do the beds stay with the facility, with the county, or do they go with Peak if Peak locates in another part of the county?
It's my understanding that the beds would stay with us because the company that left before and they left their lease early, they had to leave the beds. The beds were in our, control, our preview. So yes, when they left and the lease was, they got out early, and we rebid that based upon that number of beds. So my understanding is the beds would remain with Alamance County. We'd have to reapply, but the beds, if they're staying in that location, would stay with Alamance County.
Now, the way this happened was this facility was built something, 40 years ago?
Yes, sir.
I think, and they had to get the agreement of the county to build this and to get the beds from the state. And what happened was, in their agreement, this property reverted to the county at the end of 30 years.
I That's right.
David Cheek was the manager at the time. David didn't realize it. I was a county attorney and knew that this was happening, and we got together and presented it to the board at that time, and went out there, and I mean, it was, we don't have a dime in that property, nothing. And it's just a darn good investment so far. I don't want to do anything for 3 years anyway, but we can certainly talk to them during that period of time.
Since the building is underutilized, and it's our understanding also they have funds available for building that through the stimulus project that they have just waiting to spend money, we may be able to lease the property. You know, say if we do this, we're going to lease you the property back. You may not want the building, but we're still going to get a lease payment, but you may have to pay cash for the beds as well. I think there's a lot of ways we may be able to skin the cat that we still get, and I do agree with you as well. If we can continue to get $400,000 fits a big hole of revenue on an annual basis, and if we can make sure we get revenue associated with that over time, but hopefully along with a big cash payment for those beds. So I think there's multiple ways to do it. They want it bad. You know, I think it's nice to say it's good to have a willing buyer.
Which means that it's very valuable, and I don't think we're going to be left holding the bag with any of that out there, I'll tell you quite frankly.
We don't have anything in the
bag with the school, and we're holding a bag, in my opinion. Is there no possibility that we would ever have to spend money on a building? Is that what you're talking about?
Not in the least. Not in the least.
They're supposed to make improvements.
Yeah, they're supposed to make improvements up to
$300,000.
If we have that in the lease, that they're supposed to do that. The problem is, it's a 40-year-old building, you know, and they're not willing to put the money in to make it fully operational.
And the shape of the building is shaped like a big X, so it's not like they can take a wall out and
it doesn't flow.
Do what they need to do.
They want to build a new one, right?
They want to build a new one.
Okay. What is that land worth by itself?
And that's where we haven't, I couldn't tell you off the top of my head, but the positive thing about that, if we lease the land to them, and they built, let's say they built a $10 million property, that would then become taxable as well. So you do get tax revenue off of any new facility they may build in the county also.
So I don't want to lose money, you know.
Oh, I totally.
But there's more than one way to make a dollar, and if we could get cash on the barrelhead and get a percentage of take on the beds, I mean, there's all kind of ways to make a better deal than what we have. I just don't think the deal we've got is as sweet as everybody thinks it is.
Well, but I like what you said. I think maybe a history would help me too. And just looking at what our intermediate term options are, I didn't hear either one of you say we could offer them the Grand Manor property. That didn't.
Well, remember, somebody was in that.
That's right.
In the same business.
Well, now it's torn down, and they can build their facility.
Build their facility right there.
Do the equivalent of a 1034 for government. You can probably think something up like that, can't you?
Yeah, I can sell them that land.
But we'll be more than happy. But I do. What I'm hearing from the board is, and please correct me if I'm wrong, is we want to make sure whatever we do that it is still a revenue producer for us, and that whatever we do over time, is that this can be in the county's best interest, and hopefully whatever we would do would enhance our revenue standing.
While limiting our risk.
Right.
And the risk is having another one up here.
Right. Yes, sir.
Do you have other reports or comments for us?
Not at this time.
Okay. Next item is a motion to go into closed session. Let me preface this by simply saying that we are going to go in and talk with our county attorney about performance and goals, just exactly as we did with our county manager. This is not a personnel issue that is problematic. It also is not going to be accompanied by any change in compensation over there. It's strictly a dialogue that we have instituted with the folks that report directly to the commissioners. So having said that, I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute, Section 143-318.11A6, to consider the performance of an employee. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Bill. Any discussion about that? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. We'll go.